Good afternoon, everyone, and happy Monday. It does feel like it's been a while since we've been here. It's been about 2 weeks, actually. We had last week off for Memorial Day. Hope you guys had a fabulous Memorial Day. It was gorgeous weather here. We ended up spending the afternoon barbecuing with some friends and neighbors. It was a ton of fun. So hopefully you guys had a great time too. And I'm very excited about today's topic. We are gonna talk all about tomato diseases. We're going to talk about some really essential care tips to help manage disease in your garden. It's inevitable that your tomatoes will get diseases, so don't despair. But today we're going to talk about how to manage them, how to keep them under control so that you can get the best harvest possible out of your tomatoes. But before we jump in, let me say hello to those of you that are here in the chat. We had a great group here ahead of time. I'm usually here in the chat about 15 minutes early, and Cliff and Nisha, our wonderful moderators, are here in the chat about a half an hour early. And thanks to all of you that are taking the time out of your busy Monday to join us here. So hello to Connie from Oregon. How are you doing? Hello to Rita from San Diego. And hello to Muhammad Emil, who's saying, my friend gifted me the tomato seed collection. I have to say that they germinated so fast. Great to hear that. I'm super happy to hear that you're gardening along with us and that you're having a great time with my tomato seed collection. Great to hear. And Tommy, how are you? Great to see you here today. He's also from Southern California. And he's saying, none of them are quite red in my garden yet, but they will get there. So just hang on. Hello to Nisha and Cliff. Napertine Reflection, a Women in Gardening group. I'm recommended purchasing BT for disease control, pest control. Marie, how are you doing? Sally, how are you? Great to see you on here. Angela's Garden Sense from Maryland, land of the cicadas. So yeah, I heard they made their appearance in Maryland. Hopefully you guys are managing that okay. I cannot imagine having all of those cicadas outside. So let us know how things are going for you, okay guys? So today we're here outside. I've got a beautiful tomato plant next to me and the little tiny Tim right back here, which is doing amazing. So hopefully you guys are having great luck with your tomatoes. I wanted to mention too, it's actually drizzling right now, which is so unusual for us, especially at this time of the year. But typically, sometimes during June, we get what's called a June gloom. It's kind of a marine layer that hangs over until about noon. In fact, I gotta scoot my computer up because it's getting wet. So hold on just a second. This is crazy. It's actually getting a little bit wet. But it's a nice cool break until we have some hot weather in the 90s this weekend. But I know a lot of you have been in the 90s and 100s. So hang in there and hopefully things will cool off a little bit soon. But I want to talk a little bit about my tomatoes here. This one was a gift here from our moderator. So yes, Cliff, this is one of the tomato seeds that you sent me. This is the Megadom. Hopefully I'm saying that correctly. But this is actually the tomato I'm growing for our giant or our tomato contest, which if you haven't joined in with that, you want to head over to Gardening Coast to Coast over on Facebook. It's a ton of fun. But this is supposedly a giant tomato, and I got it from the best. Cliff Warren, our moderator, grows giant vegetables, and it is doing extremely well, has several large size tomatoes on it, which I am very, very happy about. The plant looks super healthy so far. So hopefully today, with all the tips we're talking about, it will stay that way. Now, if you don't have room for a big tomato, no worries, you guys. Grow tomatoes in a container. This is my favorite right here. This is the Tiny Tim. It's a dwarf tomato from my Container Garden Seed Collection. And it loves these little 5 gallon Smart Pots. This is the Vivid Color Smart Pots, which are now back in stock. But it's a fantastic container tomato, absolutely loaded down. There's got to be at least 100, if not more, tomatoes on this plant, and they're going to be all ripening up soon. So I'm going to be making some salsa and doing all kinds of fun stuff. So anyway, let's jump into our first tip for essential care to help prevent or manage tomato disease. Now, before we do jump in, though, I want to just let you guys know that yes, tomatoes are one of the most popular garden veggies, and you guys, they are very disease prone. So if you have tomato diseases on your, or diseases on your tomato plants, or if you haven't yet, just expect it. It's probably going to happen most likely at some point during the growing season. There's hundreds of bacterial, fungal diseases that can affect tomatoes and even some viruses as well. But here's an important thing to keep in mind, expect it. We're going to talk today about how to manage tomato diseases. And also, if your tomatoes do get diseases, don't let that make you feel like you're a failure. It happens to all gardeners, myself included. Let me just show you here. I've got a couple little tomato leaves that I actually clipped off a few plants this morning. Let me just show you what some tomato fungal and bacterial diseases look like. Typically, it's yellowing of the leaves. It can be spotting of the leaves. You can see a few little spots right here, a few small ones on that leaf, and there might be a couple on this leaf here. So typically, you will get fungus and viral diseases on your tomatoes. Very, very typical. These are little transplants that I have to get into the garden. They're actually outgrowing their little Cali Kim 1 gallon smart pots here. And these have some yellowing leaves on them as well. Some spotting. Here's one with a few spots right here. A couple spots right there. Now, these are outgrowing their smart pots, which yellowing typically happens when a plant is outgrowing its pot. So I will transplant these and they will be just fine. Now, if your fungal and bacterial diseases are much easier to manage. If your tomato plant suddenly wilts, the leaves get distorted, or it just suddenly wilts is normally what happens with a viral disease. There's really no cure for that. And those plants should be removed immediately from your garden. But bacterial and fungal diseases can be managed throughout the growing season. So with that being said, we're not going to be talking about what the specific diseases are today, because like I said, there are hundreds of tomato diseases and sometimes they can be hard to identify. And it's not really that important what specific disease your tomato has, but just that you're following the tips that you can manage the diseases as best you possibly can and do some proactive things to help manage them throughout the growing season so you can still get a really good harvest. So all that being said, the first tip to help manage your tomato diseases is watering. And super important that when you're watering your tomato plants, you water at the base of the stem. So that really helps the, when your fungal and bacterial diseases often happen when the plants and the stems and the leaves get wet and they stay wet. That's what really helps foster all that bacteria. So do whatever you can to water at the base of the plant. My favorite is to water with drip irrigation, gets the water to the roots, which when you have really strong roots, your tomato plants are going to be healthier and much more able to fend off those diseases. So drip irrigation, if you live in an area like I do here in California, where we get absolutely zero rain, although we are today, it's kind of strange. And if you live in an area where you get a lot of rain, obviously your leaves are going to get wet. There's no way around that. But manage it the best you can by watering at the base of the plant, whether you're using a nozzle, whether you're using a watering can. Do what you can to avoid overhead watering. And that way your leaves, it helps your leaves stay dry and give them a nice dry environment to help reduce the chance of disease. Now, it can especially be a challenge if you live in an area, like I said, where you have a lot of rain, you have a lot of humidity, then those diseases will be a little bit more difficult to manage. But you can take that one proactive step to really help kind of stave it off and manage it as best you have control over. So number one tip is watering. Make sure that you water at the base of the plant. Now, if you have no idea how to install drip irrigation, I highly want to encourage you to dig in and try it. I've used it in my garden for many years and we've got a whole drip irrigation playlist. But I have put a link for a specific video for how you install drip irrigation in your garden bed. We also have them on how to install irrigation in containers. It's really not as hard as you think, you guys, and it takes the guesswork out of it. I have all of my garden hooked up to drip on a timer. So that way we can go away on a vacation or for a couple of days. We don't have to worry about our garden getting watered. And it really helps take the guesswork out of it. So, go over and check out that video for all of the details. And also, you guys, if you haven't yet planted tomatoes, in some areas you can still start them from seed, especially if you live in an area like I do in California where you have a very long growing season. You want to grab the tomato garden or the tomato seed collection. For tomato seeds, we have it over on our website. And the Tiny Tim is also in the Container Garden Seed Collection, which is this one right here. And you can grab them for 15% off. having a sale running today and tomorrow with the code SALAD. And every order gets a cucumber, free cucumber seed packet. So run over and grab your seeds and get yourself some tomatoes growing. So let me hop in the chat here, answer whatever questions you might have. And we will then after that, we will move on to the next tip. I did have, thank you so much, Sally. She's saying installing drip is so easy thanks to your video, Kim. Okay, that's great. I'm really glad you're able to get it installed. A lot of people are really intimidated by it, but once you dig in, I promise you it's not as hard as you think. And then you can extend your system to other parts of the garden as you expand your garden for next year. Okay, Colleen. Hi Colleen, how's it going? Should you cover tomatoes if you expect several days of rain? That certainly is an option. A lot of people I noticed here in the chat are saying that they're having problems with tons of rain right now. Their tomatoes are splitting. You definitely could put some type of umbrella over them. I wouldn't necessarily cover them with like a plastic cover or anything like that, because with high heat and high humidity, that could, you know, really cause your tomatoes a ton of damage, if not causing them to die. But cover them with an umbrella. I've got a couple of umbrellas over me right now in case the sun comes out. I need some shade, and it's actually helping with the rain. So you may want to put a couple of like market umbrellas or, you know, patio umbrellas or whatever, if possible. Of course, in high winds, that might be difficult. Just to do what you can, or construct some type of a tarp on stakes. If it's getting really bad, that might be an option to really help protect your tomatoes from getting over soaked, because that is one sign of yellowing leaves as well. Is your tomatoes getting too much water? And we're going to talk about the next tip having to do with that in just a moment. Okay, here's a question from Dina Cordova. How you doing, Dina? Do you have any of the large cherry tomatoes growing in back? I started those and they're looking larger than I thought. How tall will they get? Thanks. Dina, I do have some. I don't think you can see them from where I'm sitting right now, but they're farther up on the hill. If you watch our video that we put out yesterday on planting a summer salad station, it was a super fun video. Got a lot of great response from it, lots of great comments. A summer salad station with 5 heat-tolerant green varieties. So go back and watch that video. I actually showed a large red cherry on that video. We have it growing up farther up the hill here on a ladder mesh trellis. I have a large red cherry on either side, so they'll grow up over the ladder mesh and then meet in the middle. I'm just starting to get some small tomatoes on it, but the plants do grow quite tall. The tomatoes tend to be, I'd say, maybe typical cherry size, but the plants can be 8 to 10 feet tall. It's an indeterminate variety, which means they're going to continue to grow throughout the growing season until they're killed off by frost, and they do produce a ton of tomatoes. And let's see here, a comment from Brian Ray. I add aspirin to my water, blend 3 in my mixer, add to 1 gallon of water. Helps tomatoes fight off a lot of diseases before they get sick. Learned it a couple of years ago and it really helps. So Brian, great suggestion. I know a lot of people do that. And if that works for you, that's wonderful. I've tried that for 1 year, but I probably wasn't quite as consistent as I should have been. I didn't see noticeable results, but I know a lot of people see great results with the aspirin trick. Gary at the Rustic Garden has a lot of videos on that. So if that's something that you want to do, head over to his channel and watch his videos on how to do that. So great suggestion. Okay. How not to get blossom end rot. I pulled off a lot of green tomatoes with blossom end rot. Irene, make sure that you are watering very consistently. If you don't get enough rainwater, put your tomatoes on drip irrigation so they get consistent water. Because often what it is, blossom end rot is a lack, or the tomato's inability to take up calcium from the soil due to inconsistent watering. So make sure you water consistently. I know Bonide Products, which I've been using a lot of those this year, also has a product called, I think it's called Tomato Rot, something like that, or Stop Rot. And I haven't tried that yet, but I will be trying that this year and bringing you guys the results, but definitely should help with that. Okay, let's jump back into our second essential tomato care tip to help prevent disease. And this is one of my favorites. If you guys have watched my videos for any length of time, you know I love this one. Mulch, mulch, mulch. Always mulch your garden, especially your tomato plants, especially all of your garden. But mulch your garden with 2 to 4 inches of mulch on any part of the soil that's bare. And there's so many benefits to mulching. One of them being that, of course, in the heat, which a lot of you are experiencing, it helps prevent water evaporation, you know, if you're not getting a lot of rain, and you won't have to water as often. So that's a huge one and very important to us here in drought-ridden Southern California. But another reason why it's super important, especially when managing diseases, is because a lot of the pathogens are soil-borne. And what that means is when water splashes on your soil and then splashes up onto your leaves, it can splash diseases up onto your leaves. So if you mulch 2 to 4 inches around the base of your tomato plants, this is gonna prevent all the soil-borne pathogens from splashing because it'll have that mulched as a covering to protect the soil. So right here behind me, I've got a couple of tomatoes planted. This is, Cliff, I have to apologize because I think this one is labeled Taihi, but I know Taihi is a giant tomato and I'm sure I got my labels mixed up because this is looking more like a morning sun tomato. So sorry about that, Cliff. But anyway, this is a Taihi tomato and I've got mulch, a couple of inches of mulch at the base of the plant here. And it definitely helps protect the soil. So a couple things you can use for mulch. My favorite, and you saw this in the video yesterday, is shredded leaves. Free resource if you have a good source for shredded leaves. And you know what you can do in the fall is just start collecting them. Ask your neighbors to collect them. A lot of times people just place them out, you know, for the trash to pick up, for the green waste to pick up. And you can go to parks, pick them up, collect them from your own yard, whatever you need to do. I actually have a big compost sack that I had collected over the winter time that is now just about empty. I've been putting leaves all over my garden. So I have started using another source of mulch. Actually, I just got this product in yesterday and I'm really liking it. I put some in my garden this morning. This is a straw product. It's called Garden Straw. And I actually got this from Kevin over Epic Gardening. And one reason why I love this, you can use bales of straw too, which is very inexpensive. But one reason why I love this is because it's shredded, and Kevin is not paying me to promote this at all. But it's shredded straw, so it's very, very convenient. And it's a very clean source of mulch. So you're not gonna get any diseases or anything like that. It's a clean source of mulch. It looks really pretty in the garden as well, and it's super easy to spread. So you can grab this over at epicgardening.com, I believe is his website. And it's really convenient. Just mulched a garden bed right back there with it, but I don't think that you can see it, but it really looks pretty in the garden as well. So I know some people like to use wood chips, some people like to use pine needles. Whatever you can do, if you have a free resource, by all means use that. But if not, you may want to go purchase a bale of straw or grab that garden straw, and just make sure that whatever you do, you mulch any bare soil that you have. Now again, mulching does not mean that your plants will be disease-free. I want to emphasize that all throughout this live stream, because eventually your plants most likely will get some diseases, but it definitely does help. So any proactive steps that you can take are definitely better than not doing anything. And Tommy's saying we have no straw here in SoCal. I know in urban areas, feed shops are few and far between, a lot less common than they are like in rural settings, in farmland and that kind of thing. But if you can find like a Tractor Supply or a feed store of some kind in your area, Tommy, give that a go. Otherwise, you know, grab some of that garden straw over Epic Gardening and you try and find a source of mulch wherever you can. Yes, definitely feed shops are a good source for that. And with regular straw, of course, it's definitely, you know, bigger pieces. So if you can chop it up somehow or just don't spread it quite as thick, it can tend to get kind of matted down. So just experiment with that and kind of get your groove on that one and then see how it goes from there. And there are lots of garden straw sources also available like on Amazon and that type of thing. So just look around and find something that works for you and that fits your budget. Okay, so what was I gonna say? Oh yeah, so make sure you go back and watch our video from yesterday because I do show you how to mulch your garden bed. I spread it lightly down in that video because I just planted some seeds. I wanted to give the seeds a nice light covering for them to germinate, but you can see in that video the general idea of how you'd apply mulch to your garden beds. Okay, Crystal Kettler, thank you so much. I'm glad you're enjoying the tips. Sarah Silva, my tomato plant has yellow and brown spots on the leaves. Is it a fungal infection? Most likely, yes. And that kind of leads us into, well, let me take a few more questions first before we go into our third tip here. Okay, let me actually, oh, I already showed you, I think, the transplant here. Yes, it has brown spots. But yes, that probably is likely a sign of some type of disease. And thank you guys so much for all of the information you're popping in the chat here of good sources for mulch. Very helpful. That's one reason why I love this community, as we all contribute and learn from each other. And that's one thing that's really nice about being here. Carl is saying try pet stores. Great idea. Wood shavings from animal supply stores. Okay, let me scroll down here and find some more tips here. And Charlene has a great question. Are you still using worm tea for the tomato fertilizer? Absolutely. I've used Vermistar worm tea and Good Dirt plant food kind of as my go-to plant cocktail. I water everything in my garden with it. I also use worm castings and compost in the planting hole at the time of planting. And then maybe a month in, I'll put another little handful around the base of my plants, you know, sprinkle the worm castings around. If I have enough compost, I'll do the same thing with the compost. And it really helps give new life to your tomato plants. But absolutely, when I find something that works, I just keep on using it, because I don't see any big reason to switch using different products when I have one that really works. You know, just keep it simple. And we are going to talk about what to do about those yellowing leaves in just a moment, so hang in there. Okay, Melissa, any wood chips as mulch can leach nitrogen from the first 2 inches. Make sure to do compost under the wood chips. But red, I've never heard of that. I'm assuming you're talking about the red wood chips you can pick up at like the garden supply stores. Wood chips, if you do use wood chips, you want to just make sure you cover them or use them on the top of the soil. Do not mix them into your soil, in which case if you mix them in, they can leach nitrogen. So if you do use them, just use them on the top and then kind of push them aside when you plant. Don't mix them into your soil. I personally would not use the red or the colored wood chips that you pick up from Home Depot. I would find a source of a good source of wood chips. I know I use cedar chips in my pathways of my garden. That's kind of a natural pest deterrent, the shredded cedar mulch. But I definitely would not use the painted mulch, as you know, that probably has paint on it. Then I wouldn't want that leaching into my plants. So a great tip there. Okay, let's head in here to our tip number three, essential tomato care tip number three to help prevent disease. And that is prune. Anytime you see a yellowing leaf on your tomato plant, you immediately want to prune it off. So for example, here I have another little tomato seedling that will be planted in the garden hopefully this week, you guys. Definitely outgrowing its little Smart Pots transplanter here. And by the way, guys, I love these transplanters. You guys can pick these up at smartpots.com. They kind of fold aside like this, so you can easily transplant your tomato seedlings in the garden. But this one here does have a little yellowing leaf on here, and I am just going to pinch it right off. I do not want any yellowing or spotted leaves on my tomato plants. You can see that little spot right there. So especially when your plant starts to get yellowing leaves, you want to be extremely diligent about checking them every day, coming out to the garden and just snipping them off with your fingertips or with a clean pair of pruners. And it is important that you clean your pruners with a, you know, a little bit of rubbing alcohol and a rag from plant to plant, because you really don't want to be spreading those diseases, especially if you're clipping off a disease plant and going over to a healthy plant. Have a couple pairs around the garden. And if you guys are like me, I'm always setting these down somewhere and losing them. So I usually order 2 pairs at a time. These are pretty inexpensive. I don't even know what brand they are, but I got these on Amazon. But yeah, definitely clean your pruners in between and make sure that you clip off any yellowing leaves that you see. Now, if you're growing a lot of tomato plants, it could take you a little bit of time. But sometimes if you're, you know, just do a walk through the garden every day or every other day or whatever, and just clip off any yellowing leaves that you see, because this, diseases do spread, especially the fungal and bacterial diseases Will spread very quickly from plant to plant. They can be spread through the wind. They can be spread through just touching one plant and then touching another, and you really want to get those yellowing leaves off. In most cases, it does signal a disease, and the leaves are not going to turn green again. So, you know, I know you're hoping that, okay, something will happen and this leaf will recover. Most often it won't. And by the way, you want to remove the entire stem. Actually, I have another little yellowing leaf right down here on my plant. Let me see if I can get you guys to sit there. There's a yellowing leaf right here. So rather than just removing the leaf, I'm going to remove this entire stem here, because most often than not, it's the entire stem will eventually be infected. It does tend to get infected a couple of weeks before it will actually show the symptoms on the plant. So you want to remove the entire stem, and that way you have the best chance possible of removing the disease from that plant. So simple tip, but it can take a little bit of time. And most often when your plant does get yellowing leaves like this, it's going to continue throughout the growing season, and you do have to be very vigilant about checking it. Now, some of you might be panicking and saying, well, then I'd be removing all the leaves from my plant. You know what? It's better to have kind of a bare tomato plant than have a plant that will be affected by disease. And don't worry about it, you guys. The leaves, most often disease starts at the bottom and works its way up. So usually we'll have enough leaves at the top where it can still get nice and sunshine, we'll still photosynthesize, and we'll still grow tomatoes on the top layer of the plant. So just make sure you get those diseases off. And also, you do want to have good airflow in your tomato plant. So when you first plant your tomato, go ahead and remove the leaves on the bottom 6 inches or so of the plant. You want to give plenty of space for the air to flow through to make sure the leaves dry. You don't want it to be super crowded, because that will, you know, tend to promote disease to grow. So remove the 6 inches of leaves and stems off the bottom of the plant. Then as the plant grows, you can remove, you know, more and more till you've got about a foot or so of the plant clear at the bottom. So very important to continue pruning your tomatoes from any yellowing or diseased leaves. Okay, and let me see here. I do have a video. Yes, I do have a video about tomato disease control. So you can go back and we'll put that link in the video description, or it's already there. And you can go back and watch that. It's a quick 2-minute tip video, and that will give you a little bit more detail on how to prune your tomato plants. Okay, let's see here if we got more questions in the chat. All right, here's a question from Fresh Landscape. How are you doing today? How do you know if your plant is yellow from the sun or a fungal disease, if that makes sense? Okay, your tomato plant is not going to get yellow from the sun, as far as I know. That's never happened to me before. Usually if it's, you're probably talking about like heat damage or something like that. Okay, that, yes, that definitely can happen. And if you have any tomato leaves on your plant that are damaged from the heat or yellow, I just go ahead and remove them, because it's never a good sign on a tomato plant. So anything that looks browning, yellowing, spotted, regardless of the cause, I would go ahead and remove it. That's what I personally do. Someone else mentioned about overwatering. Well, Eunice, if you think you might be watering too much, if your soil is super soaked, most likely you're overwatering. If you've got a lot of rain, most likely it's overwatering. I would still go ahead and remove those leaves. So that's just my personal thing that I do. Okay, let's see here. Here's a great question from Sarah about fertilizing. Worm tea has low nutrients. Is it enough for the plant establishment? Do we need to add any extra fertilizer? Okay, Sarah, you want to go back and watch my video on 5 secrets to growing tomatoes in containers. I explain exactly how to water tomatoes in containers. And the same general principles apply for watering tomatoes in your raised beds. I always give my plants all over my garden that plant cocktail that I was telling you about. The Good Dirt plant food is higher in nitrogen. I believe it has a 10% nitrogen ratio, which is really good to give your plants the first month or two till they get established, and help them have that green leafy growth, grow lots of foliage. And then about 2 months in, as they start to develop the fruit and the flowers, You'll want to, I would just maybe stick to giving them the worm tea as they develop these beautiful, delicious tomatoes. And that way you're encouraging them with the worm tea to be nice and healthy, to continue developing the flowers and to set fruit without, you know, producing a lot of leaves. However, if you do a heavy pruning, I would go ahead and give them the good dirt plant food and the worm tea at the same time, and you can definitely mix those together. So go back and watch that video for all the info on how to do that. Okay, question here from Hindi360. Why do some tomato leaves curl up? That's called leaf curl. And a lot of times that's just a response to extreme temperatures, like extreme heat, or if they get too cold, a lot of times they will curl up. It's usually not detrimental to the plant. And a lot of times it actually will correct itself. It can also be a sign of inconsistent watering. So just keep an eye on it and make sure you're consistently watering. And if your temperatures do get over 90 degrees, you guys know what I'm gonna say, make sure you cover your plants with shade cloth so the blossoms don't drop. And it helps protect your plants from stress, so they continue to produce. Okay, let's move on to tip number four. We've got four tips today. This is our last one for the day. And I know a lot of you guys probably already do this, but I definitely thought it was worth mentioning. And that is, make sure that you provide your tomatoes with plenty of support. You really don't want to have your tomatoes just sprawling out on the ground. Provide them with a nice, strong, sturdy tomato cage. You want them up off the ground to provide airflow. Of course, that keeps them away from the pests. We're having a little bit of a problem already with rats eating a couple of tomatoes that are becoming ripe, so that's always a bummer. Hard to protect them from the rats, but definitely provide support for your tomatoes so they have plenty of airflow around the plant. A couple of different ways you can go with this. You can go the DIY route, which is a great way to save money. I've got a nice sturdy tomato cage right in front of me here. There you go, that I'm getting ready to install in the garden this week. This is one of the DIY cages that we have a video on. That's two sheets of concrete remesh that are tied together with zip ties. And it provides a nice sturdy support for a tomato plant. It's quite a large cage. I wanna say it is maybe 6 or 7 feet tall. So it does provide a nice strong cage for a large size tomato. So you can definitely go the DIY route. Lots of great ways you can go with that. One of my favorites is right behind me here. We've got a Kellogg's breakfast tomato in this cage. This is two of the cages that you would purchase at the garden center. One, the top one right here is inverted. It's tied together with zip ties. It's a really super quick cage, but it ends up being about 6 or 7 feet tall by the time you put two of them together. Super quick, super easy, doesn't involve any, you know, cutting or construction or anything like that. And it's fairly inexpensive, lasts for years. That's one of my favorites. So you go the DIY route, or you can purchase tomato cages, which can be a little bit more expensive, but are also very aesthetically pleasing. This is one of my favorites. It's the Gardener's Titan tomato cage. It's quite tall. I want to say around 6 or 7 feet. You can get them over at Gardener's Supply or gardeners.com. I think it comes in a 3-pack, maybe in a 1-pack as well. And they have shorter ones if you're growing smaller sized tomatoes. So definitely make sure that you're providing plenty of support for your tomatoes, which really does help with airflow. I mean, here I'm tying up these tomatoes to this cage with my little, that one just slipped down. I need to put some more on that one. It's getting too heavy. With my garden stretchy tie tape, which is a super, super handy thing to always have in your pocket as you're walking around. I love this stuff. It's great to help support your tomatoes. It just breaks right off. So you don't need, you know, to have scissors necessarily with you. And then you can just use it to tie up your tomatoes to your support or to a stake. Now, stakes are also a great way to support your tomatoes, because you just tie them up to the stake as it grows. It doesn't take a lot of space to do that. So there's so many different ways you can support your tomatoes, depending on the time that you have and depending on your budget. So, you know, I always like to say there's no one way to do things in the garden. There's lots of different ways that you can do it. It all depends on your growing conditions, what you prefer, how much space you have, and of course on your budget as well. Now, one of my favorites the past couple years has been this tomato tower, which I got from a local family-owned garden center, but you could probably make that yourself if you're handy, but they're very pretty. I think this one is maybe 7 feet tall. I don't think you can see the top of it here, and I really, really like how it looks in the garden. So definitely use support for your tomatoes to help prevent disease. Even if you're growing and have a ton of space for them to sprawl, I still recommend tomato supports. It's gonna look nicer and neater and tidier, and you're gonna have a lot less issues with critters and with diseases affecting your tomatoes. So definitely do that. Now, the other benefit of tomato supports is that it allows you to easier manage the pruning. So you can see the yellowing leaves as they become yellow. It just makes them more visible, and you can get under there and prune them off a whole lot quicker. So definitely provide some support for your tomatoes. So guys, that's the tips I have for you today to help manage tomato disease. I know there's tons more tips, but let's run through them again real quick. Oh yeah, and I wanted to mention another one as well. So tip number one, essential tomato care is water at the base of the plant, not overhead. Number two is mulch. Number three is prune your tomatoes diligently. And number four is provide your tomatoes with some really good support. The other thing I wanted to mention too, and Cliff actually brought this up as we were emailing this morning about the live stream, and great tip, Cliff, is also look for varieties that are disease resistant. So that can be a huge help. If you live in an area, you know, especially where you have high humidity, you know, do your research, look up online varieties that are disease resistant, and then plant those varieties in your garden, because as he was mentioning, you might have one plant that looks great and a plant next to it that gets the disease, and maybe the plant that looks great has a disease resistance. Now, a great place to find amazing vegetables all across the board is All America. Why am I forgetting this? All America Selection. So go over to allamericaselections.org. I found a lot of their varieties over there. The All America Selections winners are tried, true, and tested varieties. Many of them are bred to be disease resistant, so, and grow fabulously in the garden. So go over there, look up tomatoes, see what varieties are disease resistant, and then they also have several sources where you can grab seeds. So definitely go over there and check it out. Okay, guys, we still have time left here in the live stream today to answer some questions. So I would love to take your questions live. We'll scroll through as many as we can before we hit the end of our live stream mark. If you want more information about growing tomatoes, grab my book, Organic Gardening for Everyone. Lots of tips about growing tomatoes in here. And guys, don't forget about the sale, 15% off with the code SALAD at CallieKimGardenHome.com. That runs through tomorrow. Go over and watch our video yesterday, and you might want to grab this salad in a container kit. It's a fabulous value, especially with the discount. You get the smart pots, you get the kale to grow yourself a salad in a container, and you get the heat-tolerant green salad, heat-tolerant green seed collection with all the directions on there. So it really makes it quick and simple for you to get your heat-tolerant greens growing. So let's see what questions you guys have. Oh, before I do that, guys, I wanted to let you know that we are so excited. We are just about ready to wrap, or I am just about ready to wrap with the help of my family, wrap up my second book. So hopefully this week we're getting everything turned in. That's one reason why we've been a little bit light on videos, a little bit light on social media. We've been working like crazy on photo shoots. I think we have two more photos to take, and I'm going to revise the manuscript just a bit, and we hope to have everything turned in by the end of the week. So full speed ahead with gardening season after that, and hoping to have something to announce to you guys to reveal what the topic is about towards the end of the summer. So definitely stay tuned for that. Okay, let's pop in here. Yeah, woohoo, it's been a ton of work, and we're super excited to bring it to you guys and to be wrapping up the project. Okay, let's see here. What other questions do we have? Let me scroll through here. I know we've had a lot here. Do I ship to India? Right now we are not shipping to India. We're waiting for COVID and everything to calm down. Right now we ship to the US, the UK, Canada, and Australia. So hopefully things will open up in other parts of the world in the next several months. Thank you so much, Marie. Congrats on the hard work. Appreciate that. Let's see here. Next year, get more nitrogen in the grow stage. Okay. Yeah, great idea. Rita Bonita, what's your idea on fresh food scraps directly in the garden? Is it best to bury it? I would say, for me personally, I prefer to put mine in the compost pile, as we do have rodents that tend to, you know, root through the garden. So it probably just depends on what kind of rodent issues you might have. I would prefer to, you know, compost them first. That's just my own personal way that I like to do it. Maybe you want to try with one plant and just see how it goes. But that's how I prefer to do it, is in the compost. Thank you so much, Buying Backyard Gourds. Congratulations on the second book. Thank you so much. Let's see here. Question, what's the best companion plants for tomatoes? You know what? I always try and plant basil with my tomatoes. A lot of people say that basil makes tomatoes sweeter. I don't tend to do tons of companion planting. So if anyone out there has some good suggestions as to what are good companion plants, go ahead and lay it on us there. Cynthia Rodriguez, great question. Can I use hay as mulch? I personally don't use hay. It does tend to contain some weed seeds. I don't, I try and stay away from that because I don't want any weed seeds popping up in my garden. Marigolds, yes, thank you very much. Marigolds are a great companion plant for just about anything. Their smell does tend to deter pests. So I always like to plant little flowers along the edges of my garden beds. Marigolds are a great border flower for that. Okay, Bulldog, do you let the basil go to seed? It's totally your choice. I usually let some go to seed for the bees, and I clip some to use for herbs, you know, in my cooking and all that. If you are going to harvest it, you want to get it before it goes to seed, because the flavor does change once it flowers. Shanta has a question about cucumbers and pollination. You can hand pollinate your cucumbers if they're not setting fruit. And we've got videos on that. Go and search. I think it's on a watermelon video. So search watermelon. It'll bring up the video on how to hand pollinate watermelon. You do it the exact same way with cucumbers. And definitely try that if your cucumbers are not setting fruit. Okay, let's see here. Let me see if there's any other questions here in the chat. Mika, hi there. What's your favorite new tomato you are growing this year? I'm growing green grape tomato and mini kumitato tomatoes, along with your regular beefsteaks and a few unknowns. I've got those unknowns definitely too. I'd say a new favorite has to be this one that I showed earlier that Cliff was kind enough to send the seeds to me. This is the Megadom. Ooh, my tomato stem is kind of starting to break here. I need to get this one tied up ASAP because the tomato is getting too heavy. So this one's doing very well. Super excited about to see how this one does. I always love the Tiny Tim. It's always a sure producer in my garden. Another one I'm growing is the Green Zebra. I'm trying to see. Yeah, the Green Zebra is a really fun one. It's a green tomato. It's kind of striped. It's really, really beautiful. And a good standby that I usually have in my garden, I don't know if you guys can see this one, is the Kellogg's Breakfast. I don't know if you can see that. It's just starting to set fruit. So I'm not too sure how many varieties I have planted this year. We'll have to do maybe a tomato tour if you guys are interested in that. Okay, let's see here. Yes, I'm hoping so, Cliff. I'm hoping it produces a ton. I am not planning on pruning it down to one tomato or anything like that. I just want a lot of tomatoes. If I get a few big ones, I'll be very, very happy. Vicki, we talked about mulch earlier in the live stream. So in case you guys don't know, I had a few questions about this earlier in the chat, actually. Once we stream live, the video automatically uploads to YouTube as a replay. So if you missed anything in the live stream, I always put like a digital table of contents in there too. So then you can go back through, watch the whole thing, or just click ahead to the sections that you're the most interested in. And it's a really handy way to get all the information. And maybe you don't want to sit through all the live chats and things like that, then you can just skip ahead and look at the tips. So when the video uploads, go back and watch the mulching tips. We did not get a May garden tour filmed, you guys. So sorry about that. It's just due to the busyness of the book photo shoots. We literally had our whole backyard for several weekends laid out with all kinds of projects we were doing. I can't wait to show you guys some of them. All kinds of projects that we were doing for the book, and we just could not get the time. We literally were working 3 weeks straight, probably about 12 to 15 hours a day, getting Photoshop, getting things written, getting all the photos put in the manuscript. It's quite a large project and a lot more involved than you might think. So we're hoping to do a June garden tour probably in the next week or two. A coffee walk would be lovely. I'm hoping to incorporate a midweek video as things calm down a little bit with the book. Over the next couple of months, incorporate a midweek video and a weekend video. So thanks so much for Marie. I'm glad that you enjoyed those last year when I did those. Okay, here. Can you overwater a container plant? Question from Debbie. Yes, you definitely could. You definitely can overwater. So always check your soil to see if it actually needs water. And I have a ton of tips in my book about watering. And it tells you how, my book will share with you exactly how to tell if your container plants or if your garden bed needs water. And we have tons of videos on watering as well. So you always want to check it with your finger, with a moisture meter, and definitely can overwater, even in a smart pots, which has excellent drainage. Although it definitely does help because these have drainage not only on the bottom, but all around the sides. So the water drains out, on the sides as well. And it has plenty of aeration for the plants to breathe. So if you're prone to overwatering, smart pots are a great choice because it will give your plants more oxygen so that they dry out a little bit quicker. Okay, Martha, if you've had 5 weeks of rain, you definitely do not need to be watering. All you need to do is hopefully that the rain stops and hopefully you'll send some our way because we definitely need rain. But maybe put an umbrella or some kind of tarp loosely over your plants so that they can be a little bit protected then. Okay, I'm going to take one more question. I always tend to overwater as well, Irene, so I'm right there with you. PJ, thank you so much. Excited about the second book. We are too. We cannot wait to be able to share more with you. Hindi, should I have grow lights if I have great weather all year round? It really depends, Hindi. If you want to start seeds indoors, then yes, you definitely do need grow lights. Even if you have a south-facing window, I still recommend grow lights. Even for me this time of the year, if I want to get some plants started very fast, like pretty soon I'll begin to start my late summer garden so that I'll have some plants ready to go in August. So the late summer garden seed collection has I think 5 or 6, maybe 7 varieties of quick growing vegetables that you want to plant later in the summer when your spring vegetables are starting to kind of reach the end of their season. So I'll start some of those indoors because it gets them off to a quick start. My garden beds are full, and that way when I'm ready to pull plants out, I'll have nice, strong, healthy seedlings to take their place. So if you're going to grow indoors, then yes, I totally recommend indoor grow lights. And all kinds of info on that, again, in my book. And there's links in the video description on grow lights that you can purchase for effective growing. Okay, Connie, oh, girl after my own heart there. Kellogg's breakfast tomato was my favorite tomato last summer. It's an amazing tomato, very tasty, and actually became quite large, over a pound. Yes, those and Golden Jubilees, which are in my tomato seed collection, and the spring garden, I think, are amazing yellowish orangish tomatoes, and they have to be one of my favorites. So definitely get yourself some of those growing. Okay, guys, I'm going to sign off for today. Thank you so much for joining me. Don't forget to grab your seed collections with the sale, 15% off with the code SALAD at CallieKimGardeningHome.com. Tomorrow is the very last day. So grab your seed collections while they're on sale. Grab your smart pots while they are still in stock. They're going very, very fast. Grab your salad and container kits. Get yourself some of those heat-tolerant greens planted. When you come back next week, I want to hear about the heat-tolerant greens you planted. All right, guys, have a great week, and we'll see you on next Monday's live stream and a YouTube video in between. All right, bye-bye. Thanks for joining. Bye-bye.